Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We're descendants of Abraham, and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. In a bit, we're all going to be invited downstairs for a Reformation Day celebration event. And so I'd like to set the stage for that in the sermon. And ask, why is it that we celebrate Reformation Day year after year after year? Yes, we all know about Luther posting those 95 theses to the Wittenberg door. We all know that Luther had issues with the Holy Roman Empire and the church that was its pawn. We all know that the church was in the business 500 years ago of selling indulgences and relics as major fundraising campaigns to support the building of enormous cathedrals, as well as supporting the extravagant lifestyle of the clergy. We all know that. But we also all know that a lot of years have passed since then. And we know that the church has changed significantly, and that indeed the Catholic Church has become a huge voice for social justice in the world. So why do we still celebrate the Reformation? Well, I don't think we have any idea of what life was like in medieval Europe in the church in those days. The church painted for its parishioners a picture of a wrathful, vengeful God who sat in heaven waiting to pounce upon any human being who would fall. God would pick up that human being and cast him or her straight into the fires of hell, the only thing that stood between each individual in the pew and damnation was the church. Confession was a requirement, and obedience to consequences imposed by clergy was a necessity. The clergy held all the power, and mostly due to the illiteracy of the population, were the sole interpreters of scripture for their people. But clergy didn't attend well to their own studies of scripture. But for you, as a church pew sitter, in order to understand the nature of God, would have to hear what the clergy had to say about it, and you had to accept their words fully. There was no checks and balances. This meant living under constant threat. It meant buying pieces of paper or little parts of bones of saints in order to protect yourself and all of your loved ones. Add to that the fact that there was the plague, constant warfare, the fickle lifestyle of fiefdom and serfdom, and it was really a lousy way to live or to be church. Luther, whom we shall hear from personally downstairs, there's a little shameless plug, entered the priesthood and followed his passion of studying scripture. And during his studies, administered according to the gospel. Luther had no issues with the Mass as it was celebrated, although he was clear that the ceremony itself could change according to who was sitting there and where the body was gathered. But what Luther wished to change were the hearts and the minds of the clergy who he so eloquently called pigs and dogs in the preface to the Large Catechism. Luther wanted all Christians to know the freedom that came with knowing, loving, worshiping, and having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so he wrote regarding the five solas, or the onlys of faith. Sola Scriptura, by faith, by Scripture alone. Sola Gratia, by grace alone. Solo Christo, by Christ alone. Solo Fide, by faith alone. And Soli Deo Gloria, glory to God alone. These were intended to freeze Christians to worship, to serve, to engage without fear. And I'd like to spend a little bit of time this morning talking about each one and what they bring into our lives today. For these aren't just ancient documents or ancient words, but they're living words meant for us. First, Scripture alone. Luther wrote that the written word stands gloriously alone in its majesty. It testifies to God's name. It demands reverence, unhesitating faith in its doctrines, and unfaltering obedience to its commands. The Word of God, as found in Scripture, is the very foundation of our faith, our creeds, our sermons, our faith statements, our mission statements, everything. It's grounded in Scripture. All of our doctrines and confessions are based on God's Word, as found between the pages of that holy library. It's a gift. But friends, it's a gift that's meant to be opened. One of the marks of discipleship is regular study of Scripture. The challenge of this is that we make the time to spend together in regular Bible study, that we find time each day to spend in personal and private devotional study of Scripture, opening our hearts and our ears to hear words of life that are poured out for us each and every day. Which leads us to the second sola, grace alone, whereby our salvation comes from the free, unmerited grace of God. You know, we teach our confirmation students that grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. The challenge of this is to place all of our faith in Christ, not the powers of the world, not our own successes, not worrying about earning salvation through our works, for there is no amount of service or giving or self-denial that will grant us the life and the salvation that we deserve. Our only necessary work is to respond as we are called out of gratitude for what has first been given to us. Grace is the only way to salvation that comes through the third soul of Christ alone. For it's only through Christ that we have acceptance with God. You have access to Christ. That was a huge learning for the Reformation Church. His ears are open to you day and night. His body and blood is life to you. Not from me, not from the ELCA, not from the bishop, but directly to you. It's my privilege to serve you, but it is Christ in whom you move and breathe and have your life. The challenge of this foundation is to remember that our relationship with Jesus, like every other relationship in our life, must be nurtured by prayer, as Katie said this morning, by meditation, by devotion time. We deepen the relationship we have with Christ Jesus and deepen the assurance that salvation by grace is indeed ours. Which brings us to number four. Faith. Upon knowing Christ and the sacrifice that he said it better than Luther himself. I, Martin Luther, an unworthy preacher of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, thus profess and thus believe that this article, that faith alone without works can justify before God. This is the true gospel. This is the doctrine I shall teach. This the Holy Spirit and the Church of the Faithful has delivered. In this I will abide. Faith is our resting place, place of solid assurance that Christ has our backs at all times, that we need not do anything. In fact, faith allows us, maybe even propels us forward to serve and love and make Christ's name known to all our neighbors. Why? For the fifth, to give glory to God alone. All of these things, scripture, grace, faith, Christ, they're all gifts to us from a merciful and just God who desires nothing more than that we know, love, and serve him above all things, in everything we do, in our work and in our play, in our worship and in our service, in our fellowship and in our private time. Everything we do is done to the honor and glory of God and God alone. Not to bring attention to ourselves and our good deeds, but to draw others into the saving love of Jesus Christ. That's a lot of alones. Faith alone, scripture alone, Jesus alone, grace alone, glory to God alone. But as we rely on these foundations of our faith, we're not alone in that. God has given us this great cloud of witnesses where we build up each other, where we testify to and for one another of the love of God in our lives, so that we can grow in order to train up more and new faithful disciples who will rely on Jesus as their rock and their redeemer. Today is a day to celebrate the freedom that we have from sin and death through our Savior Jesus Christ and Christ alone. This is